Hello all. So now let's start with a part of gastrointestinal system GIT, that is acid peptic disease. Okay. So acid peptic disease is a group of disease which comprise of various diseases like hyperacidity. Hyperacidity is just like heartburn, which is due to excessive production of acid in the stomach. Second is, if this acid can damage gastric or duodenal mucosa, it can lead to peptic ulcers. Okay, and sometimes this acid can go into esophagus. That disease is known as GERD. GERD stands for gastroesophageal reflux disease. So these diseases, they comprise of acid peptic diseases. Okay, now let's see what are the drugs we have for the treatment of acid peptic disease. So let's see what are the classes of drugs we have. Okay, so suppose this is a stomach. And in stomach, you know, there is a cell known as parietal cells. These cells are also known as oxyntic cells. These cells, they are responsible for secretion of HCl. Okay. So the first class of drug we have, the drug that reduce acid production inside the stomach cell. Okay. The drug which reduces the production of HCl inside the stomach cell, okay, into the lumen. Among them, we have four classes of drug. The first class of drug we have is proton pump inhibitors, okay, and they are short form, they are known as PPIs. PPI stand for proton pump inhibitor. They are the most effective drug and they have become the drug of choice in all cases. You'll write the second drug we have is H2 blockers. H2 stand for histamine 2 receptor blocker. They block H2 receptor or histamine 2 receptor. The third one we have is anti-muscarinics. They block muscarinic receptor. Okay. And the fourth one we have is prostaglandins. Okay. Prostaglandin. And which prostaglandin we use? We use a drug misoprostol. The only drug we have is misoprostol, which is a prostaglandin E1 analog we have. Okay. So these are the four drugs we have which reduce acid production. Now, what is the main purpose of using these drugs? Remember, these drugs, they reduce the production of HCl. Because of this reason, these drugs, they provide round the clock. They provide round the clock protection. Why they provide round the clock protection? Because they continuously suppress HCl production in the stomach. Okay. Now the next class of drug we have, the drug that will be given orally and that will directly neutralize the HCl which is present in our lumen of the stomach. So these drugs are known as the drugs which will cause neutralization of acid in stomach. So these drugs, they will not suppress the production of acid, they will directly neutralize the acid which is present in our stomach. These drugs, they are also known as antacids. These drugs are also known as antacids. Now, what is the main purpose of using antacid? Antacids, they are mainly given for prompt, sudden pain relief. Okay. So they are just given for prompt pain relief because they will directly neutralize HCl which is present inside the stomach. That is the second one we have. Then the third drug we have, this drug, what it will do, suppose there is a peptic ulcer. There is an ulcer which has been formed. Okay. Suppose there is an ulcer which has been formed. These drug, what they will do, they will create a protective covering over the ulcer. Okay. So these third drug, they are also known as, these third drugs, they are also known as ulcer protective drugs. Ulcer protectives. Okay. Ulcer protectives. And among them, we will discuss, there will be two drugs. One will be sucralfate. And the second drug we will be having is colloidal bismuth compounds. Colloidal bismuth compounds, various compounds we will be discussing. So they are ulcer protective drug. They will make a protective covering over the ulcer base. And lastly, we have certain miscellaneous drugs. Okay. Lastly, we have certain miscellaneous drug. The first drug you will write is certain antibiotics. Those antibiotics that will kill, that will be anti Helicobacter pylori. Because Helicobacter pylori is a bacteria which is a very common cause of, or a very leading cause of, peptic ulcers. Okay, so you will use certain antibiotics. And lastly, we have certain miscellaneous drugs like anti-foaming agent, anti-flatulence agent, etc. Okay, so many drugs will be there. So let's start with each of them. So the first drug we will be starting will be the drug that will reduce acid production in the stomach. Okay, so let's see what are the drugs which will reduce acid production in the stomach. So the first class is the drug that reduce HCl or acid production. Okay, so for that we must know that how acid is produced. Suppose this is the stomach and these are the parietal cells. Okay, these are the parietal cells. So when you see food, when you see or smell food, the sensory stimulus go into your brain, and this brain, it discharges a parasympathetic, it discharges a nerve. The one nerve will get stimulated, that is vagus nerve. Okay, and this vagus nerve, remember, releases acetylcholine. This vagus nerve releases acetylcholine, and it also releases certain factors which will promote the release of gastrin hormone, which will promote the release of gastrin hormone from G cells present in the antrum of the stomach. Okay, so what will happen due to this neural stimulation? Acetylcholine is released, and acetylcholine will help in release of gastrin hormone also. Okay, gastrin hormone also. So gastrin hormone will be released from the enteral cells of stomach. Now combine this acetylcholine and gastrin. Now what they will be doing, these cells, they will go to one typical cells present in our stomach known as ECL, that is enterochromaffin cell, and this enterochromaffin cell releases histamine. It releases histamine, and histamine is the main factor. So gastrin and acetylcholine releases histamine from enterochromaffin cells, ECL cell, and this histamine acts on parietal cells. So suppose this is a parietal cell, and this parietal cells will release HCl. This parietal cell will release HCl. So let's discuss about this parietal cell and the role of these factors in greater detail. Okay, suppose this is a parietal cell. Okay, so let's make a type of a parietal cell. Suppose this is a parietal cell. Okay, so when the neural stimulation will come, it releases acetylcholine. Now remember, the receptors of acetylcholine directly on parietal cells, we have on parietal cells is generally muscarinic receptors, we have M receptors, muscarinic receptors, and this acetylcholine, this is the minor action. It has direct action of acetylcholine on parietal cell is a very minor action. The main action of acetylcholine, the main action of acetylcholine is to release histamine, is to release histamine from enterochromaffin cell. This is their main action. Now histamine also act on stomach, and histamine act on H2 receptor. Histamine rather acts on H2 receptor, that is H2 histamine 2 receptor, plus it has a little bit role on release of gastrin also. Okay, gastrin. But remember, the main role of gastrin is again to release histamine. The main role of gastrin is also is to release histamine, and histamine act on H2 receptor. But let's see what are the receptors we have for all these chemicals on parietal cells. Let's make it now in a simple way. So if you talk about parietal cells, we have three receptors. Okay, on parietal cells we have three receptors. So let's draw this parietal cell. So parietal cell we have three receptors. The major receptor we know, this part you have to remember, is H2 receptor. This is the main receptor of H2. Okay, main receptor. And the minor receptors we have is of muscarinic receptor. Muscarinic receptor is of acetylcholine. But remember, acetylcholine mainly act through histamine release. And also we have receptors of gastrin. Again, it is a very minor receptor. It also increases through release of histamine. The receptor of gastrin hormone on parietal cell is CCK receptor. CCK stands for cholecystokinin receptors. The receptor of gastrin on parietal cell is CCK receptor. But the main receptor is H2 receptor, histamine receptor. Now, you'll write acetylcholine receptor or muscarinic receptor are of GQ type. They increase IP3 DAG level. Okay, and gastrin is also GQ type. They increase inositol triphosphate diacyl glycerol level. They increase inositol triphosphate diacyl glycerol level. But the receptor of H2 are GS type. GS is they increase cyclic AMP level inside the cell. Okay. And remember, when this finally cyclic AMP level increases inside the cell, what happens? There is an enzyme that comes to the, this is this surface of parietal cell. It is under the lumen of the stomach. In this cell, this surface of parietal cell is known as apical membrane. Apical membrane or canalicular membrane. Canalicular membrane. On this canalicular membrane or apical membrane, there is one enzyme which will come and settle due to this formation of cyclic AMP. That enzyme is known as hydrogen potassium ATPase. So how this enzyme will function? This enzyme, it will come on the apical membrane of parietal cell, and what it will do, this enzyme will throw H plus into the lumen and take back potassium into the cell. Okay, it will throw H plus into the stomach and it will take back potassium into the cell. Because of this reason, the H plus level inside the cell will increase, and passively the chloride will move also to maintain the charge. Hence the HCl level in the lumen will increase. So this is how the HCl production occurs due to this pump known as hydrogen potassium ATPase. Now remember, this pump is also known as proton pump. This pump is also known as proton pump. Why? Because in chemistry, H plus is also known as proton. Okay, and it is an energy dependent pump. So this is how the normally acid production occurs. Now to suppress acid production, let's discuss the first three drug. The first three drugs we have are, the first drug we have that will suppress this muscarinic receptor. So this class of drug we have is antimuscarinics. We have antimuscarinics. The second class of drug we have is H2 blocker. That is histamine 2 receptor blocker. And a third class of drug we have which will inhibit directly this pump. These drugs are known as proton pump inhibitors. Okay. So these drugs are known as proton pump inhibitors. Now keeping this thing in mind, can you tell me which of the following will be the best drug or the most effective drug? The most effective drug will be proton pump inhibitor, because it is the final, it is inhibiting. If you inhibit this transporter, can we say all the stimulus, they are finally converging on proton pump. Hence, we are inhibiting the final common pathway. Hence, PPIs are the most effective drug. So how we can remember? So they will decrease HCl production. Let's see how much HCl production they can reduce. Antimuscarinic, they can reduce HCl production just 40 to 50%. Okay. While H2 blocker can reduce HCl production by 60 to 80%, because acetylcholine primarily depend upon histamine receptor. The main action of acetylcholine is with histamine receptor only. While if you talk about PPI, PPI are 80 to 99% effective in reducing HCl production. Okay. So which of the following is the most effective drug? The most effective drug in reducing HCl production is PPI, followed by H2 blocker, followed by antimuscarinic. Now the acid production in our body occurs in two phases. The first phase is when you are eating something, when you eat something, there is sudden increase in HCl production, which is known as meal-induced. But when you are not eating anything, let's say you are sleeping, some amount of HCl is continuously produced. Some small level of enzyme is continuously produced. It is known as nocturnal acid production, which is sometimes known as basal acid production. Okay, basal level. Now let's talk about these drugs, in which acid production they can affect. Remember, antimuscarinics. Antimuscarinic, they only decrease meal-induced acid production. They only reduce meal-induced acid production, while these two drugs, they can reduce both meal-induced as well as basal acid production. Okay? That means these drugs, they can reduce meal-induced also. They can reduce nocturnal or basal acid production. Okay? Hence, H2 blocker and PPI are the more effective drug in that cases. Okay? More effective drug in that cases. So, first point is how much acid is produced and what type of acid production is reduced? Both. Okay? Because of this reason, nowadays we have stopped using, we are not using antimuscarinic drugs, not used. While we use H2 blocker or PPIs. Okay, but what are the names of antimuscarinic? That is very important for you. The names of antimuscarinics are, you'll write pyrenzapine and telenzapine. Okay, pyrenzapine and telenzapine, and you will write they block muscarinic 1 receptor. They are M1 receptor blocker. Okay. So, which receptor they block? They block M1 receptor, which is primarily present on stomach. Okay? So, pyrenzapine and telenzapine, they block M1 receptor, and earlier they were used for the treatment of gastric ulcers or peptic ulcers. Okay? Earlier they were used for the treatment of peptic ulcers, but now they are not used. Okay? Now they are not used. So let's talk about H2 blocker and PPI. Let's see what is their mechanism. You write H2 blocker are competitive blocker of H2 receptor. Okay, so all are competitive blocker of H2 receptor except famotidine. We will be discussing many drugs shortly. Remember, famotidine is rather competitive as well as non-competitive blocker. It has both action. It is both a competitive and non-competitive blocker. But what about PPI? PPI, you will write, they are irreversible inhibitor of hydrogen potassium ATPase or proton pump. Okay, so they are irreversible inhibitor. So let's talk about the first drug, that is PPIs. So let's start with the first drug, that is proton pump inhibitors. Okay, proton pump inhibitors. Now remember, any drug under proton pump inhibitor, it will end with the word prazole. It will end with the word prazole. Okay, that we will discuss shortly. So let's talk about what is the mechanism of action of proton pump inhibitor. Okay, mechanism of action. We already know proton pump inhibitor, they inhibit H+ potassium ATPase. They are irreversible inhibitor of hydrogen, which is known as proton potassium ATPase. It is also known as proton pump. Okay. Now, any drug which inhibits this enzyme or this pump irreversibly, remember, any drug which inhibits an enzyme irreversibly is also known as hit and run drug. It is known as hit and run drug. It is also known as suicide inhibition. It is also known as suicide inhibition. Okay? So any irreversible binding is known as hit and run drug or suicide inhibition. So what does it mean? It means that when you will give proton pump to your patient, their action, suppose you have given proton PPI to your patient, so their action will come suddenly. Okay, their action will come within few minutes, and what will happen, they will start suppressing acid production. So suppose this was the normal acid production, the acid production will decrease now. So let's say this is the acid production, the acid production will suppress. The peak suppression of acid production, their peak effect of suppressing acid production will come in 2 hours. Okay, 2 hours, and their effect will last for at least 24 to 48 hours. Or how you can remember, their effect will last up to 2 days. Okay, and this is by single administration. If you will give only one dose of PPI, their action will last up to 2 days. The reason is because they have bound to this enzyme in an irreversible fashion. Now this enzyme now is permanently dead. This enzyme now is permanently dead. That is why it is known as suicide inhibition. Now to regain the activity, you need new synthesis of enzyme. To regain the activity, you need new synthesis of enzyme, and new synthesis of enzyme takes at least 2 days. So new synthesis of enzyme will take at least 2 days. Hence, as a single administration, their effect will last for 2 days. Okay, their effect will last for 2 days. Okay, at least 2 days. And if you are using PPI on a continuous basis, if you are using PPI on a continuous basis, remember, to regain HCl production, to regain HCl production, body requires 2 to 5 days of time. 2 to 5 days of time, the body requires 2 to 5 days of time to regain HCl production. Okay, so their effect will last very long. Their effect will last very long. Why? Because they inhibit acid production permanently. Okay, now let's talk about their pharmacokinetics. Now PPI's drugs, remember, they are acid labile. Acid labile means when you will be giving them orally, when you will be giving them orally, remember, they degrade in the presence of acid. They degrade in the presence of acid. Okay, but remember, in all acid peptic disease, you will find acid in the stomach. So let's see how they have to act. PPI, first they need to go into the intestine. They must go into the intestine. From intestine, they must enter into the blood, and from the blood, they must enter into the parietal cells. They must enter into the parietal cells. So suppose this is a parietal cell. They must enter into the parietal cell from backside. Now when they enter into the parietal cell, remember, they are secreted into this canicular membrane. We have discussed, they are secreted into this canicular membrane, and in the presence of HCl, in the presence of HCl, in this canalicular membrane, in the presence of HCl in this canicular membrane, they get converted into active form. HCl converts them into active form. Okay, so what will happen, as these drugs are acid labile, they get degraded in the presence of stomach in the HCl. Hence, we have to give these drug empty stomach. Hence, PPI must be given empty stomach, because empty stomach, when the patient is not eating anything, the HCl in the stomach is minimum. HCl in the stomach is minimum. Hence, they will have minimum degradation in the stomach lumen. So remember, there should be a gap of at least, they should be given at least 1 hour before meal. They should be given at least 1 hour before meal. Second point, the other reason why they are given empty stomach, because in empty stomach, there is maximum activity of hydrogen potassium ATPase. Remember, hydrogen potassium ATPase, which is present on cellular membrane, is present maximum when in an empty stomach or during at a fasting state. Okay, but it is not secreting HCl. But the presence of HCl, this pump on canalicular membrane of parietal cell becomes maximum. Okay, hence because of these two reasons, they must be given empty stomach. The first reason why they must be given empty stomach is HCl is minimum, hence they will not degrade in the lumen. And the number of HCl, hydrogen potassium ATPase, present on canalicular membrane is maximum during fasting state or empty state. Okay. Now the second point is, these drugs are prodrugs. All PPIs are prodrugs. That means they are inactive drug, and they get converted into active metabolite by HCl. The HCl which is present here gets converted them into active metabolite, and their active moiety is known as sulfinamide. The active form of proton pump inhibitor is sulfinamide, and this sulfinamide inhibit this hydrogen potassium ATPase. From which side? From this canalicular side. From this canalicular side, they inhibit this side hydrogen potassium ATPase, which is located on the membrane. So their active form is sulfinamide. So keeping this thing in mind, can we say that these drugs, they become degraded in the presence of acid, and they are prodrug. As these drugs, they are degraded in the presence of acid, remember, hence they must be protected from the acid present in the stomach. That is why they must be protected from acid. They must be protected from HCl when they are given orally. So that is why we make enteric coated tablet. We make enteric coated tablets, or we make enteric coated capsules of these drugs. Okay, that is why we make enteric coated. Enteric means that they will, this tablet or this preparation will release proton pump inhibitor only in intestine. Intestine means enteric. So they must be protected from HCl, hence they must be given as an enteric coated or enteric coated tablet or enteric coated capsule. Okay, now let's see what are the drugs we have among PPI. The first drug among PPI which we made was omeprazole. It was the first drug among PPI to be made. Then we made many other drugs like lansoprazole. Okay, we made pantoprazole, rabeprazole, and a new addition, elaprazole. Okay, now from omeprazole we have made S-omeprazole, S enantiomer. Similarly, from lansoprazole we have made dexlansoprazole. We have made S enantiomer of pantoprazole also. We have also made dexrabeprazole. Either dex or S word will come. Okay, so they all are S isomers. Now let's talk about their property. Okay, let's talk about property. If you talk about omeprazole, omeprazole is an enzyme inhibitor. Okay, it inhibits various CYP enzymes in the liver. Because of this reason, omeprazole, it shows various drug interaction. Omeprazole, it shows various drug interaction, and it can cause toxicity of phenytoin, warfarin. Because warfarin and phenytoin are degraded by CYP enzyme in our liver, and omeprazole should not be given by clopidogrel, because clopidogrel is a prodrug. It's an inactive drug. It gets converted into active form by CYP2C19, and this CYP2C19 is again inhibited by omeprazole. Now the second point is, this CYP enzyme also degrades testosterone level testosterone hormone in our body. Okay, so remember, it reduces testosterone level in the body. It reduces testosterone level in the body. Because of this reason, omeprazole has been found to cause gynecomastia and erectile dysfunction. Okay, erectile dysfunction and gynecomastia is seen with omeprazole. So these are the specific side effects of omeprazole. Now you can write that pantoprazole has minimum enzyme inhibiting property. Maximum is with by omeprazole, minimum is by pantoprazole. Okay, minimum is by pantoprazole. So let's talk about now other drugs, other properties of these drugs. We will write that among them, dexrabiprazole, if you'll write most potent, you'll write most potent. Most potent is dexrabiprazole. It requires least dose, followed by lansoprazole, followed by rabiprazole. Okay, so the most potent is dexrabiprazole. Okay, maximum enzyme inhibiting property omeprazole, minimum is by pantoprazole. Okay, so you'll write maximum CYP inhibitor, that is omeprazole. So omeprazole has lot of drug interaction. You'll write minimum CYP inhibitor. Minimum CYP inhibitor is pantoprazole, followed by rabiprazole. So minimum enzyme inhibition is overall by pantoprazole. Okay. Next point is safe in pregnancy. Safety in pregnancy. Remember, all PPI are category B drug except omeprazole. Omeprazole is rather category C drug. Category C. So the most unsafe drug in pregnancy is omeprazole. Most unsafe drug in pregnancy is omeprazole, while all other PPI are very safe drug, and the most tested drug, which is now considered as a drug of choice in pregnancy, that is lansoprazole. Lansoprazole is the most tested drug among PPI for the pregnancy, but you can use other PPI as well, but the traditionally the drug of choice in pregnancy hence becomes lansoprazole. Okay, lansoprazole. Now let's talk about the route. All PPIs, they are given orally, all, but certain PPIs, they can be given by injection. Okay, they can be given IV. The injectable PPI are, you'll write pantoprazole, rabiprazole, S-omeprazole, and rabiprazole. So they can be given PER, they can be given by injection. Now let's see where they are used. Remember, PPI, they have become now the drug of choice for all acid peptic disease except one or two. So let's see. Remember, PPI, they are the drug of choice for peptic ulcer. They are the drug of choice for peptic ulcers. Now remember, there are the two most important cause of peptic ulcer are, one is H. pylori induced peptic ulcer. Remember, drug of choice for all peptic ulcer is PPI, proton pump inhibitor. So they are the drug of choice in H. pylori induced peptic ulcer. They are also the drug of choice for NSAID induced peptic ulcer. NSAID is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. Again, the drug of choice is PPI for both of them. Okay. Second, you will write PPI, they are the drug of choice for Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. They are the drug of choice for Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. Zollinger-Ellison syndrome is also known as gastrinoma. Gastrinoma means it is a tumor of gastrin cell which secrete high amount of gastrin, and hence they are the drug of choice for gastrinoma. But remember, the definitive or the best treatment of gastrinoma is surgery. Remove it surgically. That is the best treatment. But if you talk about drug of choice is proton pump inhibitors. Okay. Now the third use you will write, they are also the drug of choice for GERD, that is gastrointestinal reflux disease. Okay. They are the drug of choice for GERD. Fourth, they are also used in, you'll write, they are also used in stress ulcers. Stress ulcers. And they are also used in ulcers. And they are also used in aspirational pneumonia. To prevent aspirational pneumonia in an unconscious patient, in anesthetized patient, we use proton pump inhibitor. But remember, in last two condition, stress ulcer and prevention of aspirational pneumonia, here the drug of choice is H2 blockers, because they are older drugs. But now remember, PPI are increasingly used. PPIs are also increasingly used, but traditionally the drug of choice is H2 blockers for stress ulcers and aspirational pneumonia. Okay, so these are the uses. And the last point you will write, PPI are also the drug of choice for acute bleeding. Acute bleeding, ulcer in the stomach, peptic ulcer. And here we generally give intravenous PPI. Here we give intravenous PPI if there is acute bleeding of peptic ulcer. Because if HCl is secreted, remember, HCl increases bleeding. HCl increases bleeding because HCl dissolve the clot. Because clot which is formed generally stops bleeding, HCl dissolve clot. Hence, we have to reduce the level of HCl because HCl promotes bleeding. Okay. So, keep this thing in mind. So, let's talk about now the side effects of PPI. Side effect. Okay. Now, PPIs, they are relatively very safe drugs. And their side effects are only seen in long-term use. Okay. Their side effect is normally seen in long-term use. And why in long-term use? Because there is decrease in, there is continuous suppression of HCl. Because of continuous suppression of HCl, HCl or acid in the stomach has normally various normal uses in our body. So let's talk about what are the uses, what are the side effects. First point, HCl is needed for absorption of B12, calcium, iron and magnesium. Okay. Now the point is, PPIs, they reduce HCl production, but there is no effect on intrinsic factor. There is no effect on intrinsic factor. Hence, there is no B12 deficiency seen. Generally, in long-term administration, generally there is no B12 deficiency seen. But these three deficiencies are seen. Okay. Because calcium, iron and magnesium, they depend upon HCl for its absorption. B12 depends upon intrinsic factor. And PPI and H2 blocker, they don't interfere with intrinsic factor. So, because of reduction of calcium, can we say there will be less calcium and the bones will become weak? They cause osteoporosis. They cause osteoporosis. And what we have seen, that they increase the risk of hip fracture. They increase the risk of hip fractures. Okay. Second, due to decrease in iron, they cause anemia. And due to decrease in magnesium, they cause hypomagnesemia. Okay. They cause increase in risk of hypomagnesemia. Okay. Now, the second point is, due to HCl, HCl reduction increases the chance of infection. Because HCl is a part of innate immunity, it protects against various infection. So what we have seen, there is bacterial overgrowth. There is bacterial overgrowth in the stomach. there is bacterial overgrowth in stomach, and this bacteria from the stomach can go into the lungs through acid. Okay, so what we have seen that with long term use of PPI, there is increased risk of community acquired pneumonias. PPIs, they increase the risk of community acquired pneumonia. And what about intestine? They increase the risk of spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, and they increase the risk of pseudo membranous colitis. Pseudomembranous colitis is an infection due to a bacteria known as Clostridium difficile bacteria. Okay, so they increase the risk of pneumonias. They increase the risk of intestinal infection as well, because HCl, it generally suppresses infection. Okay, it generally suppresses infection. Let's move forward. Okay, let's move forward. What are the other recent side effects we have seen? Remember, PPIs, they increase the risk of dementia. They increase the risk of dementia or Alzheimer's disease. Okay, PPIs, they increase the risk of dementia or Alzheimer's disease. And there is a theoretical risk, you'll write, there is a theoretical risk of increase in Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. They may cause Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, or you can write they can cause carcinoid gastrinoma. Zollinger-Ellison syndrome is also known as carcinoid tumor or gastrinoma. The reason is, theoretical risk is because if you continuously suppress HCl, remember HCl generally gives a negative feedback. Normally HCl gives negative feedback or decrease the level of gastrin. Okay? HCl normally suppresses gastrin release. So if the level of HCl becomes less, there is no negative feedback of gastrin, the level of gastrin increases. So there is a theoretical risk of gastrinoma. And they have proven, we have seen gastrinoma in rat models. In rat models, we have seen that PPI's proton pump inhibitor may cause gastrinoma, but we have not found in humans. Okay, there is no reported incidence in human. So in animals, they may cause gastrinomas, but in humans, we have not found any case of gastrinoma. Okay, so this is about proton pump inhibitors. Now let's talk about certain new drugs among PPI. New drugs among PPI, similar to PPI. Similar to proton pump inhibitor. The first drug you will write is tenecteprazole. Tenecteprazole, remember, is a reversible PPI. It inhibits hydrogen potassium ATPase in which fashion? In reversible fashion, not in irreversible fashion. Okay. Now, the second drug you will write we have is rivaprazone and vonoprazone. Rivaprazone and vonoprazone, remember, they are potassium site competitive blocker. They block the potassium site of a hydrogen potassium ATPase. Okay, so they block the potassium site. Now, what about this rivaprazone and vonoprazone? Remember, this rivaprazone and vonoprazone, they are not metabolized by CYP2C19. Now, what does that mean? You write all PPIs. All PPI in our body, they are degraded or metabolized. Or they are degraded or metabolized by CYP2C19. Okay? Now, the point is, if you talk about a population known as Japanese low, Japanese people, in Japanese race, remember, the level of CYP2C19 is very high. So Japanese people, they show CYP2C19 genetic or genes polymorphism. They have very high level of high level of CYP2C19 enzyme. Because of this reason, PPIs in Japanese people, they become rapidly degraded. Because of this reason, in Japanese people, proton pump inhibitors are not effective. PPIs are not effective in Japanese people. Okay? PPIs, they are not effective in Japanese people. So, Japanese people, they have invented this drug for themselves. So, this drug is preferred in, it is used in Japanese people. Okay? Japanese people. So, this is about proton pump inhibitors. So, let's talk about now the next drug, that is H2 blockers. Okay? H2 blockers. Now, H2 stand for histamine 2 receptor blocker. H stand for histamine. H stands here for histamine. Now, what are the drugs we have among H2 blockers? You'll write, the first drug we have is cimetidine. First drug we have is cimetidine. And now we have other drugs as well. Cimetidine is less preferred. Now we have other drugs like ranitidine, famotidine, nizatidine, and lastly roxatidine. After this nizatidine and roxatidine, we have stopped making H2 blocker, because after that we found omeprazole, a proton pump inhibitor, which have now overtaken all the effects of H2 blocker. Okay, which has now overtaken the effect of all H2 blockers. Okay. So, let's talk about the first drug, that is cimetidine. Cimetidine was the first drug to be made, first H2 blocker to be made. But this cimetidine has certain drawbacks. This cimetidine has certain drawbacks, and drawbacks are similar to omeprazole. Okay? So, you will write, cimetidine is the least potent H2 blocker. It requires highest dose, and it is also the shortest acting. It is also the shortest acting. Second point, cimetidine again is a potent CYP inhibitor or a potent enzyme inhibitor. Because of this reason, cimetidine causes drug interactions. It causes drug interaction which is similar to omeprazole, phenytoin, warfarin, etc. Okay, so please refer to the drug interaction of omeprazole. Now, next point is it also interferes with hormonal levels. Remember, cimetidine decreases testosterone level, because cimetidine displaces testosterone from its receptor. It displaces testosterone from receptor. Because of this reason, it acts as a blocker of testosterone. Testosterone cannot act. Hence, in males, cimetidine causes again gynecomastia and decrease in sperm count. Decrease in sperm count, which may also lead to erectile dysfunction. Okay, it causes gynecomastia, erectile dysfunction, and decrease in sperm count. While it in females, remember, it increases estrogen level and it increases prolactin level also. It increases estrogen level and prolactin level. Because of this reason, it causes menstrual irregularity or menstrual disturbance. And due to increase in prolactin release, it also causes galactorrhea. Due to increase in prolactin release, it causes galactorrhea or excessive milk production. To overcome these drawbacks, we made ranitidine. Okay, ranitidine. You'll write, ranitidine is more potent. It is more potent and longer acting. Second, ranitidine has no effect on CYP. It is not an enzyme inhibitor. No enzyme inhibition, and ranitidine effect, no endocrinal side effect. No endocrinal side effect is seen with ranitidine. It does not interfere with testosterone, no interference with estrogen, no interference with prolactin. Hence, ranitidine is a much better drug as compared to cimetidine. Okay. Now, the next drug we have is famotidine. Famotidine, you will write, it is the most potent, that it requires least dose, and famotidine overall is the longest acting H2 blocker. Most potent and longest acting is famotidine. Nizatidine, you can write it as best oral bioavailability. It has best oral bioavailability. Okay, nothing special about roxatidine. So if you talk about pharmacokinetic, H2 blockers are acid stable. Hence, there is no interference with food, and they can be taken any time during the day. It can be taken before meal and after the meal, any time with meals. But if you remember about PPI, PPIs were acid labile. So they must be taken in a fasting state or empty stomach. So in this fashion, if you talk about pharmacokinetic, H2 blocker are superior in cases of acid stability as compared to proton pump inhibitors. So they can be taken anytime during the meal. Because of this reason, H2 blockers are more preferred. They are more preferred after the meals. Suppose the patient is going into bed and during sleep there is nocturnal acid production. To suppress nocturnal acid production, H2 blockers are more preferred. Okay, to suppress nocturnal acid production, H2 blockers are more preferred because after the meal there is already very high amount of acid, PPIs are less absorbed. Okay, so if a person is going into sleep, so before sleep, a patient is advised to take H2 blocker, which is better than PPI. They are acid stable because the patient at that stage would have eaten a dinner. The patient would not have been at a fasting level, at a fasting state. Okay. Now, let's talk about the property that PPIs, this H2 blocker, should not be given with antacids. And they should not be given with antacids because antacids reduce absorption of H2 blocker as well as PPI. Antacids should not be given with PPI and H2 blocker because antacids, they reduce absorption. So remember, there should be a gap of at least 30 minutes between antacids and PPI and H2 blockers. Okay, because antacids reduce the absorption of both PPI and H2 blocker. So what about side effect? The side effect of H2 blockers are same like PPIs. Okay, and what about uses? We have already discussed uses are also same like PPI, but they are more preferred in cases of stress ulcer and aspirational pneumonia, which we have already discussed. Okay, now let's talk about the next class of drug, that is prostaglandin. Okay, prostaglandin. So one prostaglandin which we use in the treatment of peptic ulcer, that is PGE1, and the drug we have is misoprostol. Okay, misoprostol. Misoprostol is a synthetic PGE1 analog. It's a synthetic PGE1 analog. Okay. Now let's see what is the normal function of prostaglandin in our body normally. Remember, normally stomach, it releases prostaglandins also. Remember, the prostaglandin which is produced in our stomach is PGE2. But as a drug, we are using PGE1. Okay. So both are same. Now what is the function of PGE1? Now PGE1 act on two types of cells in the stomach. One, it will act on parietal cell. Second, it will act on goblet cells. or epithelial cells. Okay, now prostaglandin, which is produced in our body, act on parietal cells. Suppose this is a parietal cell, and the receptors of prostaglandin E1 or E2 both on parietal cell we have is, the receptor we have is EP3 receptor. The receptor is EP3, and this EP3 is an inhibitory receptor GI type. So when prostaglandin act here, remember, it suppress or decrease the production of HCl. It reduces production of HCl from parietal cell. Okay, it reduces production of HCl. Now when it acts on goblet cells, the receptors on goblet cell of prostaglandin is two receptor. We will write, one we have is EP2 and second we have is EP4 receptor, EP2 and EP4. So these are the receptor of prostaglandin. Here we have EP3. Here we are having EP4 and EP2. Now when it acts on goblet cell, it increases, here it is increasing the production of bicarbonate, and it increases the production of mucus. Mucus and bicarbonate, remember, they are protective factors. They make a protective covering over the stomach cells. Because of this reason, acid and pepsin enzyme cannot destroy that, cannot cause ulcer. So can we say that prostaglandin, they reduce HCl production as well as they also increase protective factors. Okay, they also increase protective factor. So they reduce acid production in parietal cells by acting on EP3 receptor, which is an inhibitory receptor, and here it is increasing the production on EP2 and EP4 because this is an excitatory receptor. You will write it is GS type. GS type means stimulatory receptor. So it increases, it decreases. GI means inhibitory receptor, GPCR. Okay, now where this misoprostol is used, uses of misoprostol. Now remember, misoprostol is only used in, it is only used in, or it's a specific drug for, NSAID induced peptic ulcer. Okay. Why? Because NSAIDs, remember, they inhibit COX enzyme, and COX enzyme is required for production of prostaglandin. So NSAID, they reduce the level of prostaglandin in our body. Okay. So NSAIDs, they reduce the level of prostaglandin in our body, and prostaglandins are given from outside in NSAID induced peptic ulcers. Okay. Remember, they are contraindicated in other peptic ulcers, like it is contraindicated in H. pylori induced peptic ulcer, it is contraindicated in inflammatory bowel disease, because prostaglandin, they increase inflammation, they itself increase inflammation. So can we say that misoprostol is a specific drug for NSAID induced peptic ulcer? But what is the drug of choice for NSAID induced peptic ulcer? Remember, the drug of choice for NSAID induced peptic ulcer is again proton pump inhibitor, and proton pump inhibitor is the drug of choice for all types of peptic ulcer. Including NSAID induced, including H. pylori induced, but it is a specific drug. Now, why misoprostol is not preferred in NSAID induced peptic ulcer? Because it has more side effect as compared to PPI. Okay, so the most common side effect of misoprostol, you will write, is diarrhea. The most common side effect of misoprostol is diarrhea because it increases chloride secretion in our intestine. It also causes abdominal pain because prostaglandin causes pain or abdominal cramps. Okay, abdominal pain and abdominal cramps. And remember, misoprostol is absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. It is absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. The reason is it can lead to abortion. It increases uterine contraction. It can lead to abortion. Because of this reason, misoprostol is the drug of choice for inducing abortion. It increases uterine contraction. Okay? Misoprostol is also the drug of choice for abortion also. But for peptic ulcer in pregnancy, don't use it. It can lead to abortion. Okay? So this is about misoprostol. So let's talk about now the second class of drug, that is antacids. Second class of drug now we have is antacids. Now what are antacids? Antacids are also known as acid neutralizers. Okay, acid neutralizers. What they will be doing? They will directly react with HCl present in the stomach. So what is the mechanism of action? They will directly react with HCl, which is an acidic substance. And antacids, they themselves are basic molecule. And because of this reason, they cause chemical neutralization. It will cause chemical neutralization of HCl present in the stomach. That is why antacids, they are also known as chemical antagonists. They are also known as chemical antagonists. Okay. Now, so all these antacids, remember, they are basic molecule. They directly neutralize the acidic substance present in our stomach. Okay. Now, they directly neutralize the acidic substance in our stomach. Now, what is the main use of antacid? The main use of antacid is just to provide prompt pain relief. Just to provide prompt pain relief. Okay. In hyperacidity. Remember, they cannot heal peptic ulcer. They cannot heal peptic ulcer. And remember, they are not effective in GERD also. Gastrointestinal reflux. So their main use is just to provide prompt pain relief. Okay. Now, how do we determine the potency? How much dose of antacid is required? The dose of antacid or potency of antacid is calculated by a parameter known as ANC, that is acid neutralizing capacity. It tells us about that how many molecules of basic antacid we require to normalize certain amount of HCl present in the stomach. So it is known as acid neutralizing capacity. So how much molecules of basic antacid we need to neutralize acid? This is known as acid neutralizing capacity. And remember, the least number of molecule we require is of magnesium hydroxide. Magnesium hydroxide is overall the most potent antacid. So it requires the least dose to neutralize acid. Least dose. Okay. Now, what is the use of antacids? Remember, antacids, they are the drug of choice in pregnancy and children. Okay, they are the drug of choice in pregnancy and children for mild cases of acid peptic disease. No other drug we generally prefer to give in mild cases of acid peptic disease in pregnancy. Okay, while in severe cases we generally give proton pump inhibitors and H2 blockers. Second point you will write, what is their side effect? Remember, antacids, all antacids, when they are stopped, they cause rebound hyperacidity. Their side effect is when you stop them, it leads to rebound hyperacidity. Okay, so let's see what are the drugs we have among antacids. Drugs we have among antacids. Now, antacids, they are divided into two. Either systemic antacid or non-systemic antacids. Antacids, they are divided into two, systemic and non-systemic. Now, what do we mean? Systemic antacid, remember, after giving orally, they get absorbed into the blood. They are absorbed into the blood. Their major portion will get absorbed into the blood. Non-systemic vary minimal absorption into the blood. Okay, so normally antacid, if you are giving, they should act in stomach only, but systemic antacid, they come into the blood also, major portion. Non-systemic, very less. Now in systemic antacid, remember, we have salts of sodium and we have salts of calcium. While in non-systemic antacids, we have salts of magnesium and salt of aluminium. Okay, magnesium and aluminium salt. So let's talk about systemic antacid. The first is salt of sodium. You will write sodium bicarbonate. Okay, sodium bicarbonate. It is also known as baking soda. Also known as baking soda. Now, remember, sodium bicarbonate overall is the fastest antacid we have. Fastest antacid. But there is a drawback with sodium bicarbonate. When sodium bicarbonate reacts with HCl, it leads to production of CO2 gas. It leads to production of CO2 gas, and CO2 gas causes distension or swelling of stomach. It causes distension of stomach. Also, it can lead to, if there is an ulcer, it can lead to perforation of ulcer. So ulcer may perforate. Okay, and next point is, if this sodium gets reabsorbed into the blood, can we say it will worsen edema? Because sodium increases blood pressure in edema, and it can cause heart failure. Sodium can cause heart failure, okay, because it will increase plasma volume. And if bicarbonate will get absorbed, it can lead to metabolic alkalosis. It can lead to metabolic alkalosis. So these are the main side effect of sodium bicarbonate. Now we have made a new class of drug, that is sodium citrate. It is also systemic antacid. Now we have sodium citrate. The next drug we will write is sodium citrate. The good thing with sodium citrate is, sodium citrate, no CO2 is released. No CO2 is released. With sodium citrate, remember, this side effect of distension and perforation is not seen, while this side effect is seen, okay, because it does not release CO2. Now the third we have is calcium salt. Either we have calcium carbonate or we have calcium bicarbonate. Okay, calcium carbonate or calcium bicarbonate. Now, if you talk about this calcium salts, remember, calcium salt antacids, they are the drug of choice in renal failure. In patient of renal failure, we prefer to give calcium carbonate or calcium bicarbonate, but in low dose, not in high dose, because in renal failure, there is already calcium loss and osteoporosis. Now, the point with calcium salt is, calcium, it causes a side effect known as milk alkali syndrome. It can cause milk alkali syndrome. And the second point, remember, calcium causes constipation. Calcium causes constipation. Okay. Now, what is milk alkali syndrome? It's a very old disease. In earlier times, to treat peptic ulcer, we give lot of calcium salts, carbonate, along with milk. Okay. Calcium with milk. So, what it can lead to? It can lead to hypercalcemia, because calcium will be absorbed into the blood, and it can lead to metabolic alkalosis. Okay, hypercalcemia, metabolic alkalosis, and they both contribute to renal stones. Okay, so calcium stones will be formed in kidney. So in milk alkali syndrome, there is hypercalcemia. The symptoms of hypercalcemia is seen, like anorexia, weakness, and it can lead to renal stones. Okay, milk alkali syndrome. Okay, and it calcium salts causes constipation. Now let's talk about non-systemic antacids, that the salt of magnesium and aluminium. So let's talk about non-systemic antacids. Okay, in non-systemic antacids we have salts of magnesium and we have salts of aluminium. Now which salts of magnesium we use? We use magnesium hydroxide. We also use magnesium trisilicate. And here we also use aluminium hydroxide. Okay, hydroxide. Now let's see what is the difference we have among magnesium and aluminium. This difference is very important for you. Remember, magnesium antacids, they are very fast acting. That means they produce sudden effect. While aluminium, they are very slow acting or they have a very sustained effect. They have a very sustained effect. Second point, you'll write that magnesium salts, they cause diarrhea. They cause diarrhea or they have laxative effect. Why? Because they increase motility of stomach and intestine. But if you talk about aluminium, just like aluminium is just like calcium. Aluminium causes constipation because aluminium reduces intestinal motility. Okay, so it can lead to constipation. So which two antacids causes constipation? One is aluminium, non-systemic, and calcium. Which antacid causes diarrhea? The antacid which causes diarrhea is magnesium. Okay, and constipation is seen by two, aluminium and calcium. Okay, aluminium and calcium. Because of this reason, these two agents are combined together. The salts of magnesium and aluminium are combined together. And what is the advantage of combining? The advantage of combining them together is that they will have both slow effect and fast effect or rapid effect, both slow and fast action. Second, they do not affect motility of GIT. Why? Because this diarrhea effect and constipation effect, the first will be add up and second they will cancel each other. Okay, the fast and slow acting effect will add up while the diarrhea effect and constipating effect will cancel each other, hence they will have no effect or minimal effect on motility of GIT. And the third advantage is the individual dose is reduced or halved. So now we have to give individual dose to half. Because of this reason, their side effects are reduced. Okay. So let's talk about the side effect. Remember, magnesium salts, they are absolutely contraindicated in renal failure. They absorb a little bit, they get absorbed into the blood. That can be dangerous. Again, aluminium salts are absolutely contraindicated in renal failure. Now the point you have to remember, the side effect of aluminium is very important. Remember, aluminium reduces phosphate absorption. Aluminium reduces phosphate absorption from GIT. So aluminium binds with phosphate, hence aluminium causes hypophosphatemia. Aluminium causes hypophosphatemia in the blood. Because of hypophosphatemia, the side effect of aluminium is aluminium causes osteoporosis. Aluminium causes osteoporosis. Why? Because it causes hypophosphatemia. Aluminium reduces absorption of phosphate from intestine. And remember, aluminium itself can cause neuronal damage. It can cause brain damage. Aluminium can also cause encephalopathy. Aluminium encephalopathy, especially in cases of renal failure. So remember these two side effects of aluminium. It causes osteoporosis because it reduces the absorption of phosphate, and aluminium itself causes encephalopathy, especially in cases of renal failure. Okay, so remember this part. So let's make a summary. Remember, magnesium, it causes diarrhea, and calcium and aluminium, they cause constipation. So this is a question which is very commonly asked. So make this summary. Okay, magnesium causes diarrhea, calcium and aluminium causes constipation. So let's talk about now other drugs. Okay, you can write now certain miscellaneous drugs, then we will come to anti H. pylori drug. The first drug you will write is anti foaming drug. Anti-foaming drug will be a drug that will form a protective barrier over this HCl. HCl stomach. This drug is simethicone. So simethicone, I'm really sorry. This drug is alginate. Alginate makes a protective covering, a neutral protective covering over the HCl which is present in the stomach. Because of this reason, if this HCl moves upward to the esophagus, this HCl will not damage the esophagus. Hence, alginate is used in the treatment of GERD. Now, the second drug we have is prokinetics. Now, prokinetic, remember, they increase stomach motility. If stomach motility is increased, the food which is present in the stomach will rapidly come into the intestine. So, food enters into intestine. And these drugs, remember, they close. Prokinetic, they close a sphincter which is present between stomach and esophagus, that is lower esophageal sphincter. Remember, they also close lower esophageal sphincter. Because of this reason, again, the food will not flux upward. Hence, these prokinetics are also given in the treatment of GERD. The drugs are metoclopromide and domperidone. Okay? Domperidone. So, what is the treatment of GERD? What is the treatment of gastroesophageal reflux disease? Remember, the drug of choice for GERD is proton pump inhibitors. Plus, we add prokinetics. Plus, we have alginate. Okay. So, these are the three drugs which we use in the treatment of GERD. But traditionally, the drug of choice is proton pump inhibitor. As a replacement for proton pump inhibitor, you can also use H2 blockers. But remember, proton pump inhibitor are the single most important drug which are given for the treatment of GERD. So these three drugs we use in the treatment of GERD. Now let's come to the next class of drug, that is ulcer protective. Ulcer protectives. Okay. In ulcer protectives, we have two drugs. The first drug we have is sucralfate. And second drug we have is colloidal bismuth compounds or bismuth salts. Okay. Colloidal bismuth salts. So, we will discuss various salts of bismuth. Now, what is the function of these drugs? Remember, these drugs in stomach, in the presence of HCl, they require presence of HCl or low pH. They always require presence of HCl and low pH. Remember, the sucralfate is only effective. The sucralfate is only effective when the pH of stomach is less than 4. That means acidic. And similarly, colloidal bismuth salts are only effective when the pH is less than 5. Okay, that is very low. Now, what will happen? These drugs in very low pH, both of these drugs in low pH, they get polymerized. So, why they require low pH? Because in low pH, both these drugs, they get polymerized. And suppose this is an ulcer. This is an ulcer in stomach. Suppose in stomach, there is an ulcer. And when they become polymerized, remember, they get precipitated or attached over this ulcer. This is known as ulcer base. So when they get polymerized, they form a protective covering over ulcer base. Okay, so they require low pH to produce their effect. Okay, so we have two drugs, and these drugs are hence known as ulcer protective because they form a protective covering over the ulcer. So let's talk about the first drug, that is sucralfate. Okay, the first drug we have is sucralfate. Now, from where this word sucralfate has come? Okay, the word this sucralfate has arisen from, you'll write, it is sucrose. So sucrose, then you are seeing AL word is coming. AL stands for aluminium, and then you are seeing 8 word is coming. 8. So it is aluminium sulfate. So we have taken 8 aluminium sucral. So sucralfate word has come now. Okay. Now, what is the mechanism? We have already discussed. Sucralfate in low pH of less than 4 or acidic pH, it polymerizes and forms a protective barrier over ulcer base. Okay. Now, because of this reason, remember, sucralfate should never be combined with, it should never be combined with antacids, H2 blockers like ranitidine, any drug, any H2 blocker, and any proton pump inhibitor, because these drugs, antacids, H2 blocker and PPI, they tend to increase pH of the stomach. They tend to increase pH of the stomach, and if the pH of stomach increase, sucralfate will become ineffective. Because sucralfate requires low pH for its action, these drugs should never be given because they increase the pH. Okay, they make the pH basic. Okay, they make the pH more than 4. So it should never be combined with antacid, H2 blocker and PPI. Remember, there should be a gap of at least 30 minutes between sucralfate and these drugs. Hence, if you are combining these drugs, if you are combining sucralfate with this drug, this combination is non-scientific. It is irrational combination. The combination of sucralfate with ranitidine, antacid, PPI is an irrational combination. It has no scientific basis. Okay, it has no scientific basis. So let's talk about where this sucralfate is used. Now, this sucralfate, remember, it is given for the treatment of all types of ulcers. Okay, it is given for the treatment of all types of ulcers. So let's see what are the uses. So, oral sucralfate is given for the treatment of erosive esophagitis. And here, what happens? The ulcers get formed in esophagus. It happens in cases of GERD, erosive esophagitis. Second, you will write peptic ulcers. Peptic ulcers. You can also give in rectal ulcers. In rectal ulcers, it can be given like enema also. Okay? And remember, it can be given topically as well on skin ulcers. If there is any ulcer on skin, we can apply topical sucralfate also, like ulcer due to burns, bed sores, diabetic ulcer, etc. It can be applied on skin also. Okay. Now, what is the main side effect? The main side effect of sucralfate is due to aluminium. And we know the side effect of aluminium. Aluminium decreases phosphate level, which leads to hypophosphatemia. Because sucralfate contains phosphate, it can lead to osteoporosis. And sucralfate can also cause encephalopathy, especially in cases of renal failure. Okay, in cases of encephalopathy, it can cause in presence of renal failure, it can lead to encephalopathy. So it should not be given in renal failure as well. Okay, and we know that aluminium causes constipation. So sucralfate will also lead to constipation. So same side effect of aluminium. Let's talk about now bismuth compounds. Now bismuth compounds also act when the pH is less than 5, and they should not be combined with other antacids like drug. Now these compounds, remember, they are prepared in colloidal solution. They have a colloidal solution, hence they are known as colloidal bismuth compounds. And we have two preparations of colloidal bismuth compound. The first we have is colloidal bismuth subcitrate. We also have colloidal bismuth subsalicylate. Okay, so we have two preparation, either subcitrate or subsalicylate. Okay, now let's see what is the mechanism of action of bismuth compound. The exact mechanism is not known, but remember, they are protective for ulcer, which we have already discussed. They protect ulcer. Remember, they increase prostaglandin release in the body, and we know prostaglandin is protective for us. Third, remember, they are also pylori. They cause pylori detachment. That means they are anti H. pylori drug. What they do, suppose this is the stomach and these are the cells. Remember, H. pylori bacteria, Helicobacter pylori bacteria, it never invades into the stomach cell. It remains on the surface. This bismuth compound, they cause separation of H. pylori bacteria from the surface of stomach cell. Hence, they have anti-H. pylori effect. Okay. So, remember, these are the proposed mechanism of bismuth compounds. Because of this reason, these bismuth compound, if you talk about their use, they are the part of they are used in anti-H. pylori drug for the treatment of peptic ulcers due to H. pylori. So we both subcitrate and subsalicylate are used in the treatment of H. pylori. But if you talk about subsalicylate is also used in treatment of other bacterial infections like traveler's diarrhea. Subsalicylate is also given approved drug for traveler's diarrhea. Which one? Subsalicylate. Both the drugs are approved for H. pylori, but subsalicylate is also approved for traveler's diarrhea. Now, what is the main side effect? Remember, the color of bismuth is black. Because of this reason, it causes black tongue, black feces. It causes black tongue and black feces, and rarely it may produce neurotoxicity, and it may cause a fatal side effect, Ray syndrome, but very rarely. Okay, very rarely it may lead to Ray syndrome also. Okay, so this is about ulcer protective drug. Now let's talk about certain new drugs. new drugs in acid peptic disease. The first drug you will write is CARB, binoxolone. Carbinoxolone, remember, is a drug which will directly increase mucus production. It will directly increase mucus production. So it is sometimes or rarely used, not available in India much. Side effect is it causes hyperkalemia because it increases aldosterone production also. Second drug you will write, ribamipide and icabet. Ribapimide and icabet, remember, they also increase prostaglandin production, and we know that prostaglandin are protective for the stomach. Prostaglandin are protective for the stomach. Okay, now the last part we have is antibiotics for the treatment of H. pylori. Now, which antibiotics are approved for the treatment of H. pylori? We will write, the first antibiotic you will write is the main drug, that is clarithromycin. Clarithromycin. Second, you will write is amoxicillin. Amoxicillin. Third is metronidazole. You can also use the congener of metronidazole, that is tinidazole. The fourth drug is tetracyclines. And you can also use levofloxacin. So these are the antibiotics which are approved for H. pylori. So let's see what is the treatment of H. pylori peptic ulcers. Overall treatment of H. pylori. Okay. Overall treatment of H. pylori. Okay. So these are the antibiotics which are approved. So let's see the treatment of H. pylori infection. Okay. Now, in the treatment of H. pylori infection, remember, there are certain principles which we have to follow. We have to follow certain principle. Remember, we have to give combination of antimicrobials. We have to give combination of antimicrobial because resistance may develop. Resistance develops easily with single agent. With single agent, resistance may develop easily. Second point, remember, it should be given for at least 10 to 14 days. The therapy must be given for at least 10 to 14 days. And the third point is, we have to decrease acid suppression also. We have to decrease acid suppression. Why? Because decrease in acid suppression increase the efficacy or effectiveness of antimicrobials. Acid suppression increases the effectiveness of antimicrobial killing on H. pylori. Okay. So for acid production, remember, the drug of choice is proton pump inhibitors. If it is not given, then replacement is H2 blockers. Okay. Hence, the drug of choice is PPI. So let's see what is the treatment regimens we have, which regimen we generally give for the treatment of H. pylori. So if a patient of H. pylori will come, the first treatment we start is known as triple regimen. First regimen we start always is triple regimen. So in triple regimen, we give three drugs. Okay, we give three drugs for 14 days. Okay, these three drugs are, first is proton pump inhibitors, PPI. Second is clarithromycin. And either we give metronidazole or amoxicillin, any one drug from them. This is known as triple regimen. Okay. Now, if there is clarithromycin resistance, the main drug is clarithromycin, but if there is resistance to antimicrobial, then we switch over to quadruple regime. Or other regime which I will be telling you. In quadruple regime, we use four drugs. We use four drugs for 14 days. So these drugs are again PPI. Then we have colloidal, bismuth, salts, either subcitrate or subsalicylate. We use tetracycline. And we give metronidazole. So these are the drugs. Now, what are the other options we have? Other options we can give is sequential therapy. These are the some other options. In sequential therapy, we give therapy in two phases. Okay, first we give proton pump inhibitor with amoxicillin for 5 days. Then we give followed by PPI with clarithromycin and metronidazole for another 5 days. That means 6th day to 10th day. Okay, this is known as sequential therapy. And in resistant cases, you may add levofloxacin. Okay, so remember this part. Now the point you have to remember, the proton pump inhibitors which we are using here, are given twice a day. Remember, PPIs in H. pylori bacteria are given twice a day. Okay, one before breakfast, empty stomach, and second is before evening meal. So it should be given during empty stomach. Okay, before breakfast and empty meals. So this is how we treat H. pylori infection, and this is all about acid peptic disease. Okay, so thank you very much.